Hello and welcome to the second video in the series Machine Learning Foundations. In our previous video, we talked about what is machine learning, how it differs from traditional programming, and how it all works from a very high level. In this video, we will discuss the ML pipeline from a very high level and also talk about different career landscapes in machine learning. Having a big picture perspective, I believe, makes it easier to work on the individual components later. Therefore, I'm making this video. I hope you enjoy this video and will watch it all the way through. Let's get started with the video. Consider a popular application of machine learning, spam classification. As the name implies, the goal in spam classification is to categorize incoming email into categories spam and not spam. Let's see one way of addressing this challenge using machine learning. The first step in approaching any machine learning problem is to gather the relevant data, which in this case is a collection of spam and non-spam emails. Let's take a closer look of the content in a spam and a not spam email. Can you identify the spam email? Intuitively, if an email contains content that is irrelevant to the email recipient, then it must be spam. Irrelevant content can be identified by watching out for sentences, phrases, or even words within the text of the email. But what words constitute irrelevant content? By monitoring the actions of the recipient on past emails, we can surely infer this. Words, phrases, or sentences that mostly appear in the previous email that the user chose to mark as spam are more likely to indicate irrelevant content. Intuitively, such past emails can be used to identify the differentiating aspects of the content that typically appears in spam emails versus relevant emails. I have now marked the words that appear in collections of spam and not spam emails. And this is what machine learning models do. Therefore, a simple strategy to classify spam could involve measuring the relative proportion of words and phrases that are commonly found in spam emails. We have the data now. Each example consists of an email and its manually assigned category, the so-called label of the email. Such dataset is known as label dataset. Now, textual content may not be directly amenable to learning because much of the machine learning involves mathematical operations. To facilitate numerical computation, some approaches to text classification convert the text into vectors of word counts, or some scale proportion of their occurrences in the email versus rest of the corpus. Similarly, textual categorical labels are also converted to numerical form, say -1 for spam and 1 for not spam. Such steps to arrive at a suitable input format for machine learning are known as pre-processing the input. After pre-processing, each input is represented in terms of features and their values. That is the word and its count in our case. Pre-processing converts each input email into an instance which is a tuple of feature values and corresponding labels. In this table, each row is an instance and each column, except the label one, represents the feature value for that column. Some approaches may choose to arrive at intelligent transformations of the input instead of mere word counts. For example, an approach may choose to associate counts not to individual words but to group of words and their synonyms that most distinguish the categories. Such intelligent input transformation strategies that are guided by the classifier model are known as feature extraction. Some words within the content may be irrelevant to the classification task. For example, common words such as the articles the, an, a, or prepositions like at, for, in, of, may be meaningless in the context of classification because they are equally likely to appear in any communication, spam or otherwise. Removing irrelevant features from the input examples, thereby retaining only the relevant information, is known as feature selection. This two-step process of feature extraction and then feature selection is our third step, called as feature engineering. With the training dataset ready after pre-processing, feature selection, and feature extraction step, it is time to actually train the predictive model. Some predictive models work by comparing feature values across categories and identifying the features and values that differ the most between the two. Some approaches, on the other hand, may use a parametric form to model the classifier. The parameters are selected in such a way that when combined with the input features, they result in accurate prediction. The parameters could, for example, be a real valued vector, the parameter vector. We can check the sign of the inner product of this parameter vector with the input vector. If it is positive, then the email represented by the input is not spam. If the output is negative, then the corresponding email is most likely spam. Irrespective of the particular modeling approach, the goal of any classification approach is the same: accurately predict the category of the input instance. Training classifiers involves discovering patterns in the input that make such accurate predictions possible. This means the parameters or the discerning features should be discovered such that they maximally distinguish between the examples in the training set. This process of identifying such differentiating patterns is known as learning or training the classifier. The classifier is itself considered a trained model at this point. Before we can be confident that the trained model is effective at automatic categorization, we also need to understand the performance of the model. The ability of the model to perform well on examples that were not part of the training set is known as the generalization ability of the model. To estimate generalization ability, we evaluate or test the model on examples that the model has not seen during training. Unseen examples used to evaluate the generalization ability of the model is known as the testing set. In the case of email classification, the testing set consists of more emails with manually assigned categories. To test, we first let the classifier predict categories for these test emails without revealing the actual categories for those emails. Then we evaluate the classifier performance by comparing the predictions to the corresponding actual categories. A simple score for evaluating classification performance is the accuracy score, calculated as the fraction of predictions that were correct. A trained model with good generalization performance is ready to deploy. And that is how the machine learning pipeline works. In the upcoming videos, we'll learn about different algorithms that are used to train a model, how they work and why they work, and how you can tweak them to solve your specific problem scenario. But for now, I hope you get the big picture of how it all works. Since you are following these tutorials, I'm assuming you are also interested in learning more about the opportunities available in this field of study. There are four major roles: a data engineer, a machine learning engineer, ML ops engineer, and an AI researcher. Trust me, there is a lot of hype surrounding it, and frankly, there is not a lot of distinction between all of these roles. There isn't really a fixed boundary that says this is one specific career path and this is another completely exclusive career path. They kind of overlap. However, understanding these career landscapes and how they overlap is important. So let's talk about these roles. A data engineer is someone who comes from a statistics kind of a background and has working knowledge of data systems and platforms. They are responsible for building data pipelines to bring together information from different source systems and preparing the data for analytical and operational uses. Big organizations have the ability to collect massive amounts of data, and they need these people to ensure that the data is in highly usable state by the time it reaches the data scientists and the analysts. Fields like machine learning and deep learning won't succeed without data engineers to process and channel the data. This is a good starting point for someone who don't have very strong software engineering or computer science backgrounds, but understands concepts like relational and non-relational databases, cloud storage, cloud computing, etc. The machine learning engineer is the most hands-on person and comes from a computer science kind of a background. If you can write neat codes, write good documentation, and have a very good idea about computational speed, and you probably have done your data science and algorithm courses very efficiently, I would say then definitely machine learning engineer is a path ahead for you. A machine learning engineer does not have to be at the edge of the research, so they are not reading papers, you know, day in and day out, but they still need to be sort of familiar with machine learning algorithms that exist. The AI researcher is the person who's very updated about all the recent advancements, reads up research papers, understands and implements them, re-implements them in their own way, kind of tweak these algorithms to better suit to their problem that they are supposed to solve. So this is broadly the domain of research right now. The researcher is not bothered about where the data is stored, how the optimization of that entire process would look like. Again, this sort of overlaps I mean, as a researcher, you could also be concerned about some of the things, but broadly when the industry is talking about the researcher's role, that's what it sort of looks like, and normally these people are coming from a strong maths kind of a background or have some kind of computer science research background, because this sort of role requires you to have a lot of curiosity and a lot of creativity. And most importantly, patience, because you have to be reading up research papers day in, day out. That is sort of your bread and butter. And then creativity, because you have to also innovate, right? You have to innovate for your particular problem that you have at hand. So all of that understanding is something that is central to the machine learning or AI researcher's role. The MLOps engineer comes from a very strong software engineering kind of a background. They take the algorithm, put it into the production, and make sure that the entire serving process is streamlined. That is the optimization for loading time, the optimization for running of the models, optimization for, you know, querying the database. All of that is basically kind of the forte of the MLOps engineer, I would say. There is also a role known as the data scientist. The usage of the term comes from more of a business analyst kind of a background. This role is kind of similar to the AI researcher, but very different. If you look at the organizations where you don't really require someone to be innovating at the edge of the research, so you don't need to be reading research papers day in and day out, but you still need to be sort of familiar with the machine learning algorithms that exist, because basically you are solving problems that are not like extremely difficult, but that are required on the go. You can just kind of work out a problem for a week or two and get some results, use it for getting business insights, and that's what mostly a data scientist is responsible for. This role is suited mostly for people who don't need to be as hands-on with software engineering or cutting-edge research. So this is a very sweet zone for most people, because it's really easy to get into, and once you are in the data scientist role, you can either transition into a machine learning engineer kind of a role or an AI researcher kind of a role. Normally when you are starting out and if you don't have a strong software engineering background or a strong statistics kind of a background, it is very easy to get into starter roles in data scientist kind of positions, and then you can choose your journey and transition into whichever role you like. So that's broadly the career landscapes possible in machine learning. I hope you got the idea. That is it for today. Thank you for watching the video. Have a nice day. See you in the next video.